As Mohammed said, I like had really little time to prepare this, but I will just like in this discussion to go over some of the exercises he gave during the lecture, and then I think also there are some common questions people have been asking me, so I'll just go over that. So if you don't mind, let me first start. So let me just recall. In his lecture, we define three possible rings that you can look at, or three possible chains on the base loop space. You take either not complete these chains on base loop space, or take some special completion. But then for each of them, you can define a module. So in his notation before, it was called ML. This is, if you did the exercise quasi-isomorphic to floor chains of L. So, remember, we have a Q. Let me just, Q and L, they're total, let's just say they are tautologically unobstructed, which is something he defined, means it doesn't bound any disk. And in some closed manifold. Then we can define three modules. So one of them is just take floor coaching complex, Q, but with this special local system, take chains on the base loop space. You fix a base point, Q. So Q is a base point. And by this dot, we mean this local system at X takes the path space from Q to that point in Q. OK? Do I need to recall this, or we're fine? OK. So this is one of the module. This is a module over, if I'm being precise, there should be a Novikov of field, where we consider chains in Novikov field. So so this is a module. Obviously, you can just act by loops on this chain complex. On this local system, and then, I will do an example later, but the claim is this, which this group you should think of, since the elements in this base loop space, the chains on it, if we were writing this notation, we're taking a finite sum, right? So this is a finite sum of possible things coming from the Novikov ring, Novikov field, and then where this sigma I is some chain, is the preferred ground field, if you want. OK, so then you similarly, you can define ML hat. Also, you're supposed to think that's quasi-isomorphic. So I mean, I'm just translating everything into floor theory now. So, but then now you look at a completed ring. So this is a module over this ring, which is also appeared in his lecture. But the difference between the first one and the second one is possibly to be an infinite sum. I'm just gonna be sloppy, right, things like this. Of course, you will have the usual condition that this is triadic convergence. So that means that this exponent eventually goes to infinity. So I goes to infinity. So this is the usual completion you will look at. But then in the lecture, there also appear to be a special kind. Let me just say, so let me first take this epsilon guy. So it all depends on which thing you're, okay, what kind of convergence you're allowing. So this is a ring, this is a module over a special ring like this, where the sum allow still can be infinite. But you want, so this is due to the result of Grofman and Solomon that if you look at this, so this is the only condition here is that the sequence goes to infinity. But in this ring, it says that the sequence goes to infinity in a per squared rate that it has to be larger than the length of the generators. So we also define length here. So this growth has to be faster than this, so that altogether it still goes to infinity. Okay. Sorry. Let me just double check. Yeah. So this is the where sigma is still something. Anyway, so obviously. This is a special kind of completion because we are looking at some special kind of rates that's going to infinity. Okay, so let's look at all this in a special example which he gave. So in his lecture one, we had this cylinder thing. We're fixing S1. So you're supposed to think this is a Q, and another guy, L, wrap around like this, where area of this disk is A, area of this disk is B. So let's assume, we want to do the case with Novikov coefficient, so let's assume A is bigger than B for now. So the area is not the same. So we had the exercise to compute what happened in the first and the second case. That's what he gave in the lecture. So you're supposed to compute this ML, So let's first look at the first case. What happened to this chain complex if I look at this kind of Lagrangians in T star S1, you can think of. So as a chain complex, this thing is just generated by, so its definition is that it's generated by X, which lies in the intersection point. So I take chains, from this per squared base point, let's fix the base point. For example, just by convenience, let me say base point is here, to the intersection point. So really in this example, we only just have two intersection points. X is the front intersection, Y is the back intersection. So this chain complex will reduce to the case that you just have two direct sum of Q in our coefficient, sum where Q is now equal to S1. Okay, so this is our chain complex. Then where we want to compute its homology. Okay, to do that, you first have to think about, so obviously these two things are modules over chains on the base loop space of Q. And there is a way to to think this as a differential graded algebra. The way you do this is that you first change your original definition of base loop space to be the more loop space. So that means that instead of looking at maps from prescribed interval 0 to 1, you look at for any length to Q. So that if you do things like this, you don't have a concatenation to be A infinity. You just have a strict product on chain level. If I use a special chain complex later, so and whenever he write this like chains on the base loop space, a correct model for this is really taking cubical chains. And normalize it. But this would mean that it's n simplex, just gonna purely be generating by maps from interval to Q. Modulo by normalized would mean that modulo maps that's degenerate, so if gamma is a module of those sigma, which is degenerate. And the sigma is degenerate means that it factors through a lower dimensional parameter space. So M is less than for this.
What do you mean the loop space instead of
Q? Oh, yeah, sorry. I want to define this for any manifold, but here I'm in loop space. Questions? Maybe? Okay. So if you use this model to compute your chains, so it gives you a model for the chains on the base loop space of Q, and if I fix a parametrization of these loops, then essentially you can see that. So I want to claim is that in the case of S1, you compute this homology using. So I didn't tell you the differential, but differential is basically just restrict to the boundary map. Like this is just like a version of a singular chains where you're using cubes. So then. Okay, chains. So if I take homology for S1, what I get should be with Novikov coefficient. So this is something easily can be checked. It's just Laurent polynomial in Novikov coefficient, because basically everything is supported in degree zero. If you think about it, I mean, you have a base point over there. I'm mapping, I'm mapping like a n-dimensional family into this. If I fix parametrization, then really what's left is it's only the degree zero guys survives if I model degeneracy. So. This z and z inverse corresponding to if I fix an orientation on S1, the wrapping number around each of the, like how many times you are wrapping around this. So that's why like somehow in this example, he gave this ring showed up eventually. But
if you're computing the homology of the base loop space,
yeah,
is it always true that for the base loop space of S1, then it's also basically zero? Or do you have to impose this moving out by degeneracy condition?
Oh, no. I'm doing this because at chain level, I get a DGA. That's a nice structure. But homology is always this. Chain model, you can take other model. You can compute this by singular homology, then you still get this result. But I want a nice chain level structure. So that so the claim is that if you take this normalized cubical chains, then you think about the product. Okay, product originally, if you just take singular chains, for different simplices, you have to do subdivision. But take a cubical chain, so you can just take domain. You just take the product and map these two maps in each vector. And then this normalized thing, because if you don't normalize, you can compute cubical chains for the point. Then you find this cubical homology for the point. Then you find this is even infinite generated, because there are some if you think about the homology, I mean, the way it's defined, it will have like a generator in each every degree. So you don't want such a thing to appear, so you have to take normalize, so that you see, when you take normalize, if the target manifold is just a point, it has to be a point, right?
So you're saying H star here, but what you really mean is that C star, if you look at the chain complex, it doesn't have anything in dimension. If you, the chain complex would only have something in dimension zero
if
it's degenerate.
Yeah,
well,
yeah.
Otherwise it would have chains in arbitrary dimensions, which of course would contribute.
Right.
So, but I mean, on the chain level, if I take model the degeneracy, then this is a nice model for base loop space. So if I take this, this is always a differential graded algebra. And given by the Pontryagin product on the base loop space.
Sorry, but I don't understand. Why don't you want chains at every level, at every degree for the point? That happens for singular chains.
I think actually if you do this cubical chains, just even for homology, it might be have some.
Yeah, what you said was correct. Singular homology, if you don't model the degenerate cubes, you don't get the homology of a point.
Get
Z in each even degree.
Right. I mean, chains on chain you have higher support too, but then on homology level you also have higher homology in higher degree. So then this is something that you don't want. You want to prescribe.
You have one thing in each dimension.
Yeah.
And then you have a D which might whatever it is, it's some
nice morphism. Yeah, we can control later.
Can
yeah, but that. You should change that to H, I think. That's C.
Oh, okay. Going back and forth.
My correction was wrong. You're correct the first time they said it.
My point is, okay. My point is, okay. This thing is at chain level supported at each degree, but on homology is also, if you don't take normalized chain, it will also support it at some degree that you don't want. So it's maybe infinitely. Yeah, I think it even has infinite rank. I might be wrong. I did this exercise at one point. Because basically you will have some alternating things show up. So this is explaining you why you take normalized here. So the point is we want this. Then we want to compute this homology. Sorry, I'm going so slow. Okay. Oh, okay. But then this means I have to redraw the picture. Okay. So we already have the chain complex over there. Did I write it down? Yeah. So, okay. So if you write down this chain complex, x and y, basically you will say that it has to be of this form. So let me change to S1. So it's like easy to see. Shift with the index of y. And there's some map here, which we don't know yet. Oh, star, sex. Yeah. Sorry, my nose is a little bit. I want to go from Y to X. Okay, but basically you have to count this J holomorphic strip contribution, right? So let me just, so since I didn't want to talk about index, let me fix the index of Y to be one, and zero, index of X to be zero. I mean, up to renaming them, you have this. Then you want to count the contribution of this disk and that disk. So if the holomorphic strip should have some orientation given by the gradient flow line, let me fix their orientation like that. Then you want to, so basically this map in Muhammad's talk is given by evaluation of this moduli space to the path space between X and Y, right? So that means that so if you look at the contribution from this one, first of all, it's a error is A, so T to the A. Then you have to consider, so this map is given by concatenation of evaluation of the fundamental chain of strips between. So if I have a moduli space, Q and L, and in this case is if I fix orientation here, Y and X, you want to evaluate, so this is the moduli space, Y, X. Okay. But it has two contributions. So first of all, the first one will give you, so if it's, the first one will give you evaluation on this loop. So it has a prescribed direction here. So let me call, we don't have color chalk, okay. Let me call this loop. Gamma A, the other evaluation to be gamma B. Okay, because I give you the direction, you just evaluate them. So this is the first one is gamma A, and should be some orientation here. Let me just claim to be this one. Okay. So this is concatenation here. So I want to, so this is just a path space, but I want to identify this to be. So this is in the case of S1, so it's just a rank one module over the base loop space of S1. This map is just, oh, I mean, everything is Novikov coefficient here. This map is just by concatenating a path. So here you would like to, since we have chosen a prescribed the base point before, Q. This map here is just given by I choose a path from Y to Q and concatenate that. Okay? So intersection from this intersection point to Q. And so then I can any path here, I can complete it to be a loop, to be well-defined. Also here, I choose another one from intersection point of X to Q. So in this situation, I just choose these two paths. But it doesn't depend on your choice, the eventual result. So then, okay? So under this isomorphism, we want to say, what is this map? Okay, so you go around. you will see that so we basically have to do certain path concatenations. So you first, let me say, go from Q to Y, and then this map here is like concatenation of its inverse. Concatenate this gamma B TB minus TA. So my claim is that, if you want to go into detail, you can do that. My claim is that one of these paths gonna run around this S1 once, the other one give you a trivial contribution. Maybe you can see that here. Let me see which one's running around. Let me check this one. So supposed to go from Q to Y, and then
I think it's impossible to do that on the board.
Yeah, I think I have like notations.
The one is with ones and the other is zero. I think you should just say that.
Okay. I checked this. One is running around once, the other one is running around zero times. So that's how you see there's a contribution of Z here. So then if you take homology here, I mean, this is basically, this complex have some certain differential. So this is another complex. So this is a bicomplex. You can first take homology here. Then you will see that this is exactly what I claimed before. And this map descends to homology like this. Because basically, I've already identified the positive direction of wrapping with Z. So whatever the non-trivial contribution will give me a component of Z here. So in my calculation is this. Anyway, you guys can check. So there's a Z inverse here. Anyway, so this is what you get. If you pass homology, then you can compute homology of this complex. So, so you will see that since this element, up to multiplication by Z, this is, let me multiply by Z on both sides, this is just that, right? Then from this complex, you can see that homology of, so C, that's, let me denote homology of each of them to be HF, okay? Maybe with a hat added later. So this thing is this local system thing. Basically gonna be non-trivial because you are now to invert. So what you can do is that write this to be this, right? If this is isomorphism, then that means this element is invertible in this ring. But basically, if you want to invert this element, you start to see infinite series, right? Just use a geometric series expansion. And then you will see that it's not possible to invert this element in the first ring, so that homology is not zero. But then in the second ring, just like what I just said, because you can invert, this is isomorphism. Notation is so complicated, sorry. This is, has to be zero because you can write this. It makes sense in this completed ring. But what we get from this point of view, because I have assumed this A is greater than B, then that means that I could have Hamiltonian deform this Lagrangian L to a one that's Hamiltonian isotropic to it with a nearby S1, so that this S1 doesn't, so this is what Mahal was saying in the lecture, so that this S1 doesn't have to be, doesn't have to intersect this S1 here. So what you want is that this module, you ask, is quasi-isomorphism type, this module here, is quasi-isomorphism type, is it invariant under Hamiltonian isotropy? The answer is that, so also in his lecture, he stated that if you look at this head version, so quasi-isomorphism type of this is invariant under Hamiltonian isotropy. But you can see from the other one, because obviously one is zero, one is not zero, because they don't intersect. So this one is not. Okay, so this is what you get from this exercise.
It's not under Hamiltonian, it's under non-Hamiltonian isotropy. They're all invariant under Hamiltonian isotropy, but the point is...
It's not invariant under Hamiltonian isotope.
So ML.
No, it's not, because I can Hamiltonian isotope this L, to because there's some positive error here, right?
Oh, I see. You can invariant.
Yeah.
You can isotope that so
yeah.
It's disjoint. You say.
Yeah.
Okay. Sorry.
But also the first module, which turned out to be non-zero, was defined in this case only because we were really lucky and the moduli space was really small.
Yeah. I mean, I'm just...
Otherwise, this thing didn't exist.
Yeah, sure. I mean, I could have a look at this finite sum thing. And you can still define it, I think. It's just not invariant the Hamiltonian isotope.
But your map, which you define, which is a concatenation,
yeah.
This evaluation map,
yeah.
That may involve many...
Sure, but I mean, but I thought in this complex because you're only taking finite sum, because the other component is only finite. The chains, by writing this, I mean, there's some ambiguity about how he defined this.
The finite sum, so, the T's can be infinite series because they're just elements of the Novikov.
Yeah, but then if you look at this sum...
Finitely many singles.
Yeah, so then this is my point. T can be infinite, but simplex can only be finitely many. So when you take this sum, you're not going to get infinite sum.
Yeah,
right?
It's always well defined.
It's not like we are lucky.
But what is your map? Right? You have some differential in ML. And that was defined as sum over all classes A in relative pi 2 of T to the A evaluation of the moduli space of strips in that class.
When I evaluate, I basically get some element in the base loop space or pass loop space.
I think there is a mistake that you should allow the coefficients to be arbitrary elements of Novikov ring.
I'm allowing that.
But when you write it like that, you should, I mean, there can be infinite sums of T's.
Yeah.
The first C star on the right.
If you put an F instead of the T, where F is some Novikov polynomial, then what number series then?
Sure. I mean, T is there something in the Novikov, like a poly Novikov field. So then,
Yeah, but like by definition, that's the linear combinations with kind of coefficients belonging to the field, Novikov field. But when you write it like that, since you have your own finitely many things, it doesn't cover everything.
Oh, I see what you mean. Okay. Yeah. Right. Fi is seamless. Okay. So,
the second one should also be Fi, and then you're asking if its valuation goes to infinity.
Sorry.
Evaluation
of effort. Okay. Questions?
The module ML is a direct sum of two things.
Right.
What is a differential do on the other side?
The differential is as a DJM, so this complex is the ML. The differential is this map between the two summand, right? I can. Does that?
I don't think that Mohammed mentioned in the lecture, but in the differential, you know, when you have the sum and you concatenate with the evaluation of the fundamental class of the moduli space, blah, blah, you also have to differentiate in the chains, right?
I mean, yeah, I already differentiate chains over here because I first take the homology of this chain complex, then I. Right? I was saying this thing on the board is a double complex. Is that making sense?
I think for the last two, it would be okay. T to the alpha.
Yeah, I also think so. So it's just because this T to the alpha is notation in his lecture, so I got confused. He didn't write this out, so I did this thing, and then got confused about that. Anyway, but in this way, you don't have ambiguity. But then, because this can be infinite in both components, it doesn't matter if I take lambda or not.
But now there's this slight confusion of, I'm just algebraically confused.
Yeah.
Because, so this is, this is the full completion where the homology vanished and we lost information.
Yeah.
But then the intermediate completion was the one where we got this.
So I haven't got, you mean this is the intermediate thing that we're
I think that the way you've written it now with the valuation, it looks to me like this Akinoid ring.
Yeah. It is that thing. Yeah, because I'm basically, so in his lecture, there are only three types of things showing up. Later, he used something about epsilon. So basically, this P, so epsilon is some kind of convergent radius of some analytic function. And his P is taking in epsilon ball, the polytope. So later, he changed his notation again because he wanted to set up he wants to define this region analytic space, and that space is only nice if you look at a polytope. But now we're just looking at any epsilon now, which also this ring also show up in the first lecture. Any questions on this?
But I think the point is that if A minus B is bigger than epsilon, then 1 over T to the A minus BZ is in the ring, and therefore that the thing vanishes. But if A minus B is less than epsilon.
Right. Yeah, exactly. I was going to say that. I'm just going to remark on that because I also have other stuff. So you can also look at what happened, right? What happened of this chain complex I'm writing now with this ring here.
Right.
So that exactly depends on
So it depends on the relationship of alpha, like you said, with this difference, then in one case it vanishes, then the other case doesn't vanish. I mean, you can do the same exercise here. Yeah.
Right, so if a minus b is big, it's bigger than epsilon, mm-hmm. then it's the coefficients of z to the n will reach infinity faster for it to be in this ring, mm-hmm. and therefore.
Yeah.
So that's why he's saying he gets a little bit of stability, where if you just move a tiny bit, then you can use this intermediate ring and the same sort of system.
Yeah.
Right.
Okay.
So, Jim, even if it's not a torus, you still get alphanumeric domains? I think maybe.
Oh, no, because I was talking in S1 case, really. Only in torus case. So, I haven't changed my notation to P yet. Okay. I'm just saying that later this P showing up when we look at the Lagrangian torus vibration and want to build a mirror. But up to this point, nothing about that yet. Everything can be defined using this epsilon without polytope. So this is later. We're gonna look at the case that. So if your Q is Tn, so before nothing is Tn yet, then basically from this computation we did for it's already behind the board. We did the computation for homology of S1, or base loop space of S1. Okay. So using this fact here, you can get a Laurent polynomial when you look at base loop space of Tn, basically. Let me just use this notation. So it means that a Laurent monomial, it's an n-tupled, okay? Just by projecting to each factor, you can get this. So if I pass to homology, so basically everything here is chain level, right? So I can pass to homology if I have a Tn. Then, because of this thing, you will see that. Homology of, let me maybe write it here. So you can pass to homology for each of them in the case as restrict to Tn that we're interested. Really, you know what I mean. I don't want to waste time. Okay. And this one has a prescribed epsilon with it. And this thing is a module over the homology. So now the homology here is just Laurent polynomials in n variable. So this is what Mohammed meant, that these are the algebraic function on a punctured complex torus, since each of them give you you're supposed to think in this situation where you have Novikov ring instead of the usual mirror symmetry where you have C star, but really you have to analogous to that. But this one, what are we doing? Is basically a completion so that you complete in Novikov parameter direction, but you also complete in the ZI direction. So they are the homology classes for these. So later So this is his notation in class. But really, these are Laurent series. So they are allowed to go into infinity by this bracket, formal Laurent series. So these are the algebraic formal neighborhood of what you have before. Series. But then this one is saying that we're taking something, a module. Actually, later we're going to show this. This thing even is a coherent module. So at each point, for each specialization, the rank of this stays the same. But it's only true when you look at the homology of this kind. So in his notation, I think he changed to P here. but let me just put epsilon. I mean, I just meant the homology of this. So this thing show up in the last lecture. Is bad notation? okay. So okay, so if we have this, the point of this discussion is that if I look at, really, okay. So we want to compare a Fleur chain complex of one fiber, which is given by Q in this case, with a nearby fiber. So to compare that, you have to consider, so if this family of Lagrangian isn't Hamiltonian, then there's some fluxed contribution from this variation. So and this is going to be important because that's exactly capturing the area difference between different J holomorphic disks. So what I meant is that so I have something. So for example, I have a Lagrangian like this, another Lagrangian like this, which is L. So this is just S1 now. For each element alpha in S1 of R, S1 is just fiber. I'm specializing to the case of S1. Then you can define the flux to be take a representative of this alpha, then look at graph of alpha. So let alpha, for example, be some harmonic one form. Then graph of alpha is some well-defined nearby fiber in the cotangent bundle of S1. Okay. Then I can look at the path from 0 to alpha, interpolate by T alpha. For these family of forms, you can represent it by harmonic forms. I mean, these are homology classes. Maybe I should do this. Then represent by some one form, graph of them Ft to the alpha. Okay. Then this flux thing is just given by you evaluate the area swiped out by these nearby fibers. So this point is alpha, Q alpha. So you can evaluate alpha on any homology class in H lower one. To be the error shaded here. Okay, and this is important for us because, so basically what I want to say is that we want to look at what happened if we move this Lagrangian by a little bit, and how much is exactly controlled by this alpha in this H upper one. And then you want to look at a nearby fiber. This alpha is controlled by this. And then obviously, so in his lecture, he has this, well, Foucault's trick, which basically saying that you can choose some J holomorphic, choose some almost complex structure and some diffeomorphism so that when you pull back the diffeomorphism of the original almost complex structure, this disk contribution here is identified with the original disk contribution here. But then, so these contributes to the flourishing complex between alpha, S1 alpha with L. So D alpha counts U alpha, which is this shaded thing. But then, where are the color chalk? Oh, okay. Or no? No, I mean, no color chalk?
It's probably under the table.
No, I don't say anything. Anyway, so I just read. But then there's another disk, like here. So this U contributes to the differential in this flourishing complex. Okay? In this picture. Okay, right? Oh, okay. Well, anyway, let me. Oh, yeah, I mean, sure. Okay. But I want to continue with my discussion to save time, sorry. I think everybody know what I mean. Well, anyway, so this thing counts that. But then the differential also counts area, right? So the key point where flux comes in is that you have to estimate this error. This error between the error between one, okay. So this thing in green, but it shows that in yellow, is the difference between the energy of U and different energy of U alpha. And to first approximation, this is, so Muhammad actually estimated a precise form for this, which I can talk about more, but then the most important contribution of this is actually just the flux. So you're supposed to evaluate this alpha to this generator, so to the boundary of U. So that means that although in my picture, this U boundary of U only go from here to here, right? But in principle, what could happen is that this disk might wrap around this fiber in multiple times. So then you actually have to count this flux multiple times. So this is like roughly, I can tell you that plus some error. So this pairing is exactly given by the flux. Okay, and then but then this contribution may happen in every single direction. We're just doing this for one S1. So that's why eventually you're adding all these Zis. So basically what happened is that you're supposed to think of this Zi is some formal deformation of the original chain complex, such that if I plug in
z to be t to the alpha. And this alpha is the one form here. Then if I evaluate the original differential with this evaluation, then I will correct my error by this amount. Is that okay? And then, well, then the error here, what I mean by approximately this is because really, for example, in this picture, the wrapping number is zero, right? So you don't get any contribution from here. But then you can actually choose a zero section of base point and the written out. So think of this intersection as a sheet over this zero section and write this as a graph. And think of this intersection as another sheet over this zero section and write this as a graph. Then this shaded region is exactly the integral of this one form subtract the integral of this one form, because it's exactly count error from here to here subtract the error from here to here. So this E, so this error you can actually control by the flux and choosing some base point in this way. So this choosing base point is in the end of his lecture where he's saying that when you do actually like a change of chart, you have to consider like in different chart how these errors behavior will behave. So the upshot of this discussion is that using this flux variable and then the chaos trick, you can actually define an isomorphism. So if you look at the completion in the end, this completion give you a module over this ring that later you can specialize to different z value to get the corresponding fiber, which represent the fluorocoating complex with a nearby fiber. So so if I want to look at the origin L with a nearby alpha, Q alpha, then in this ring, okay, let me do everything with epsilon for now, since I didn't talk about the Q yet. So, okay, so this ring, Right, this is correct. So I can look at the original ring. Which defined just for Q. And then I can tensor this over this ring. And then take a special fiber. Nearby fiber like this. And where this map is the map he introduced in the talk. So basically you need a map to specialize this fiber. So this is like a ring of function on a neighborhood, but now you're just looking at one point. I I can say something about it, but maybe am I already? Yeah, I know. Yeah, but this basically this map is exactly you evaluate z at t to the alpha because we want to go to alpha, and then the flux of looking at the fiber at q and q alpha is exactly given by evaluation, like I said, and then compose the Foucault's trick map that you can actually identify the disk contribution with this chosen diffeomorphism for each nearby fiber.
Your isomorphism sign there, this is again quasi, right?
Yeah, I mean, everything. I mean, this one, no, I mean, this isomorphism, this is isomorphism. But if you want to, so this is, okay, so there is, in his lecture, he basically stated this result using the ML that I used at the beginning. Everything here is quasi-isomorphic. Actually, so this result, I think, he might say it in the end, but I mean, we didn't really have it in this form. But I basically want to change this notation into Fuller theory and tell you what happened in this case. But then in each case, this isomorphism just shows strict isomorphism. Sorry, any questions on this? Or short question for anything?
Do you want to say something more?
I'm done up to here, but I don't know. Questions?